Well, good morning, Grace people. It is good to be with you here today. We are continuing through the series Mark My Words. And truth be told, we kind of left Mark in the dust a little while ago as we've gone on from the gospel story into some of the epistles of the New Testament, some of the letters from Paul. Today we're going to be dipping into some from John as well. But what has happened over the past 3 and now 4 weeks is we've sort of stumbled upon an unintentional sub-theme in this series. And the theme is, what does the church need in order to prevail? In order to move forward, for the church to succeed, for things to keep moving forward the way that God intended, what does the church need? And last week, we heard Pastor Darren preaching, who's next? Who are we raising up? Who are the next generation of leaders? They're not out there somewhere for us to bring in, but the leaders that God is raising up need to be in here and locally grown and cage-free, might I add. The week before that, Andrew Kelly was preaching on unity, that the church needs to have a unified sense of what they have in common. Not the differences, but what do we hold together? And we said the Apostles' Creed together. And then the week before, the prior week, Pastor Darren again preaching on faith, hope, and love. And today, I'm going to be focusing on the greatest of these, which is love. Love, love, love. There has been no lack of ink spilt over the subject of love. It is the most returned to and recurring theme in literature, in books, in movies, in songs. And because I love music so much, and because I love you so much, we're going to listen to a sampling of love songs spanning the decades from the 1950s to to today. So, if you know them, sing real loud to tell everyone which decades you're from. All right, here we go.
I wonder who wrote the book of love. Thank you, baby. Yes, I do.
How sweet it is to be loved by you.
I'll be the hero you're dreaming of. We'll live forever knowing together we did it all.
Not a lot of 80s babies. I'm only sad that the live stream didn't get my sweet calf moves. That is unfortunate. Well, give yourselves a hand. That was very nice. So I love music. I also love my wife, and I love my kids. It's a different kind of love, but it's a very real love. Today is Mother's Day, so happy Mother's Day to those mothers out there. No, and also with you, I'm offended. All right, generally speaking, it's a mother's love that creates a safe space in the home for the kids. They create a safe, nurturing environment for children to flourish. And generally speaking, the mother's the one who speaks the language of the children. That is often a mother's love. A father's love is different, but complementary. While the mother speaks the language of the child, the father tends to speak the language of the world so that when these adorable little children who have been nurtured and loved so well walk out the front door, they don't get smacked by the world and crushed by it. That's a father's love, to prepare them for that. It's a different kind of love, but it's love nonetheless. What else do I love? I love Oreos. Oreos. Does anyone else love Oreos? And does anybody? I have less than I had at the first service because they just came up and swooped in like a flock of terrifying birds. Because I said, if you would like an Oreo, just come on up here and get it because I need some. Really, Lily, I'm serious. Lillian, if you want one, you just come get it. Yeah, there's one. Yeah, there we go. Come. But I need a couple people up here for an example. And so only a few people can fit up here. So what we'll do is you guys take first. And then I need somebody responsible. Oh, you can't leave yet. You have to do something. This isn't Grace. This is Oreos. Nothing. You don't have to do anything for Grace, but for Oreos, don't eat it yet. How many rules are you going to break? I didn't tell them to you. It's not fair. How many more are there? I'll give you a bonus one if you can follow the rest of the rules properly. All right. Okay, so just stand up here, except for you that just ran away. And so what I want you to do is twist it. Twist it open so we can see the two cookies. Who doesn't have it yet? Just somebody responsible. Hold these. Not going to lie, you don't look that responsible, but you can have them anyway. All right. All right, get one for yourself and pass them back. All right, so we're going to twist them open and show everybody. So what we have here, an Oreo is three things. It's a chocolate sandwich cookie on one side. It's a chocolate sandwich cookie on the other side. And then it's a sweet, creamy, delicious stuff filling in the middle. And believe it or not, everybody, this is exactly what we're going to be covering today in our scripture reading. That's right. Don't believe me? Head back to your seats with your Oreos, and you will hear. Let's give them a hand for being brave. Okay, yep. All right. So we're going to turn in our Bibles to 1 Corinthians 13, and as the time unfolds, you will know what any of that has to do with the Oreos. 1 Corinthians 13. Okay, Andrew Kelly went over the situation in Corinth a couple weeks ago, but for a little reminder, here's a quick recap. The city of Corinth, biblical Corinth, was a diverse colony full of all kinds of people from all over the empire, mixing all kinds of cultures together. It was a port city, and as such, it was the original sin city, as many port cities could have been. Their slogan was, "What happens in Corinth stays in Corinth." The Apostle Paul planted a church there which was riddled with disunity, and they were divided over all kinds of issues. Who should they follow? Did it depend on who baptized them? Do I follow Apollos? Do I follow Paul? Do we follow Jesus? How and who should they marry and when? Also, the Christians in Corinth, they were suing one another, just like any other civil argument might end in. They were arguing about what type of food they should eat and what was appropriate and what wasn't, and much, much more, including spiritual gifts. That's just a funny thing in this line of things that it's like, also, you guys, spiritual gifts. This is kind of like the biggest deal here. So we're back to our Oreo. All right, let me get one here. Oreo. Cookie one. Cookie one is 1 Corinthians chapter 12. That's where we're starting. 1 Corinthians 12. Arguments in this chapter are all about gifts, these spiritual gifts, and which one was the most important. I think it was interesting that the church was exercising so many spiritual gifts, so much so that they had to, like, argue about it. But spiritual gifts are different than talents or skills. They're not just what you're good at. Spiritual gifts are given by the Holy Spirit for the purpose of building up the church. And we can see the list of gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. They are wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, speaking in tongues, and interpretation of tongues. I have exercised some of these gifts. The Spirit's given me knowledge, which is like knowing things that you have no business knowing about a situation. It's figuratively reading people's mail. I literally do not read other people's mail. And then also prophecy, which is really speaking to people on behalf of God and having a word that they're like, whoa, that is so timely. And how did you do that? It's a spiritual gift. To my knowledge, I have not yet received one gift that I've been praying for, which is the gift of healing. I would love to be able to pray and have the Holy Spirit heal people. I haven't seen that happen yet, but I keep praying for it. And you can do that too. You can pray for spiritual gifts and see what God responds to you. The specific issue for the Corinthians is that they are comparing gifts. Anybody here ever compare yourself or what you have or what you do with other people? We're not like them. No, I haven't either. People are saying, basically, na, 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 I can speak in tongues and you can't, or I prophesy and you don't. But Paul comes in and he responds, hey, knock it off. We are part of one body and Christ is the head. We're all different parts of it and you can't just cut people off. Is your foot more important than your hand? Is your eye more important than your ear? If you were to cut off your nose, how would your feet smell? Don't answer that. This is the argument that Paul is walking people through, and that is cookie number two. When we get to 1 Corinthians 14, in brief, in 1 Corinthians 14, Paul tells the churches of Corinth that their gifts should be used in worship for the building up of other believers and to build up the church, not to get attention for themselves, not to make themselves seem more important than other people. That defeats the whole purpose of this. And what's interesting is you could actually go from 1 Corinthians 12 to 1 Corinthians 14 and have nothing in between it, and you feel like you would not miss anything about the argument. It starts with, you guys are doing this. That's not good. Do this instead, right? Sounds like the conversation I have with my kids. But what is missing is the best and most important part, the sweet Oreo filling. And do you know what that is that we find in 1 Corinthians chapter 13? Love. You've heard of it. Love. 1 Corinthians 13 is famously known as the love chapter, and for good reason. If you've ever been to a wedding, Christian or not, you may have heard some of the words inside, which we'll be reading momentarily. It's the quintessential marriage chapter. My wife and I have even hung the passage in our bedroom in a very prominent spot, even though it's about church conflict. It can also be about marriage, because it turns out these are very helpful relationship words. So, with no further ado, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting at verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It doesn't envy. It doesn't boast. It isn't proud. It doesn't dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It isn't easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Love always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. It's a beautiful poem. I mean, that's just a fabulous description of what love is, and it's very appropriate for helping us to love really in any relationship. Now, to be more true to the original language, we're going to translate the words about what love is into what love does, because these were all originally written as verbs. So you'll hear that in a second. And also, we're going to read just the sections around it, so that we can really hear what Paul is getting at. And remember, so we're coming out of arguments about gifts and whose gifts are more important than others. Paul says, you should eagerly desire the greater gift. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but don't have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy, and if I can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give everything I have to the poor and give over my body to hardships so that I can boast, but I don't have love, I gain nothing. Love waits patiently. Love acts kindly. It does not envy. It doesn't boast. It doesn't behave proudly. It doesn't dishonor others. It does not only look out for itself. It doesn't get angry quickly. It doesn't keep a running list of ways it has been offended. Love doesn't delight in evil, but love rejoices with the truth. Love always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. Always perseveres. Love will never fall away. But where there are prophecies, they'll cease. Where there are tongues, they'll be stilled. Where there's knowledge, it'll pass away. For we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, aka when Jesus returns, what's in part and incomplete disappears. And now, these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Now, why is love the greatest? I'd say several reasons, but here it's interesting that he mentions faith, hope, and love. Faith, when Jesus returns and we see him face to face, we no longer have need for faith because our faith has become sight and it's right before us. So there goes faith, that's completed. Hope, when Jesus comes again, we no longer have to hope that Jesus is coming back because he's back. So there goes hope. We have what we've been waiting for. We don't have to hope for it. But love remains. Love will never pass away. And what Paul is saying in this paragraph, or in this section, in this chapter, in this letter, what he's communicating, I'd say in summary, is without love, you can do all the right things and still be wrong. Without love, I heard a over here. Yep, you know. Without love, you can do all the right things and still be wrong. So, question. Is love that important? Is love that important? I mean, we write books about it, we sing songs about it, we long for it, we even pray for it. What is this mysterious force, and why are we so obsessed with it? Well, this quote has made its way around the internet in the past decade, attributed to Albert Einstein. There's an extremely powerful force that so far science has not found a formal explanation to. It is a force that includes and governs all others and is even behind any phenomenon operating in the universe and has not yet been identified by us. This universal force is love. Now, what would make that quote super awesome is if Albert Einstein actually said it. Sorry, romantics, he did not. It was debunked. So, from a more reliable source than TikTok, dear friends, this comes from the letter of 1 John, chapter 4. The Apostle John writes, "Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. Anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God, but anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love." God is love. Love is important, indispensable even, because God is love. Without love, I would argue that people become projects. God's righteousness becomes culture wars, and Jesus becomes a mascot, nothing else. So let's take a look at each of these. We'll go with some more Oreo examples. All right, so people becoming projects. Cookie number one, it's a person. We'll call him Frank because that's his name. So Frank is here. Cookie number two will be down the road. You want your friend Frank to know Jesus. And so you could just try to talk to him and argue and have the right words and convince him that, like, yeah, this is how you should believe, and these are all the true things, and you need to turn or burn. But what's missing? Sweet Oreo filling. Love, the thing in the middle that binds it all together. With love, that might actually happen. You might be able to win over, in partnership with the Holy Spirit, your friend Frank. And another one, righteousness becomes culture wars. So if cookie number one is how the world is, and cookie number two is how God wants the world to be, there seems to be a strong push out there that says, well, we can just legislate things to be right. We can force people to behave more like God wants them to, and then we'll be a Christian nation. And it's missing something. The sweet Oreo filling of love. What God calls us to, how God calls us to enact change through love, to be a loving presence in the world, in which people say, wow, maybe what you're talking about is better, huh? And the third one, Jesus becomes a mascot. So here we have Jesus, the cookie, and over here we have our discipleship to Jesus and our identification with Jesus. And if you just call yourself a Jesus person, but there's no love, there's no evidence, there's no sweet filling actually connecting you to him, are you really, is what the writer of 1 John would ask. Love is the evidence that this relationship is real. There's a really interesting statistic out there I've heard many times, and maybe you have too, that Christians divorce as much as secular people. Anybody heard that? 50% statistic, it's right out there. I see some heads nodding. So what does it really make a difference? It's sort of a skewed statistic because there's different kinds of Christians, right? I don't mean denominations. I mean, if I were to just tick a box and say I'm a Christian, that's what gets counted. There are plenty of marriages where that's the case, where it's just nominal Christianity. People call themselves that without any evidence of following Jesus, without belonging to Christian community, without remaining connected to the vine, as the deep roots make good fruit value would remind us to. And these relationships, divorce rates, of nominal Christians are actually higher than the standard, than the average of 50%. It's more like around 60%. But for those Christians who are reading together, scripture together, they're praying together, they're serving together and serving one another, they belong to a Christian faith community, that percentage goes way down, way down. Because love is that important, the love that we have for God and for each other. So it's important because I'd say love is the stuff of God. It's what God is. It's his essence. And it's the stuff that takes us from where we are to where we hope to be, where we hope for others to be, where we hope for our world to be. Love is the thing that gets us from here to there. And I believe we can get there. I believe we can get there because the reason that we can love, that we have the capacity to, is because we're so smart and we're so capable and we're so talented, and by golly, if we just pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, we can just do it, guys. Well, that's what everybody on social media seems to think. Just try harder and you'll do better. I think we can love because God loved us first. We have an eternal wellspring, this infinite source, this inexhaustible force of love with which to draw from, and it is God himself. Now, for some of us, when you hear God loves you, you're like, yeah, I know, I got that. That's awesome, and I'm so glad God loves me. And there's this confidence of God's love for you and his presence to you and the way that he loves you. And then for some of us, you could hear that every day. You could hear God's love you, and it still won't sink in. It'll just never get there. And it's just, you know, I don't know if it's a personality thing or an emotional thing, but that's not important because thankfully, whether you can receive that or not, it does not change God's position about you. You are still loved. You might think, I don't even know if I love God. But hear his words to you, again from 1 John. God showed us how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. So our fundamental position then before God in Christ is we're loved. And that's foundational. And if you miss it, you've literally missed the gospel. You've missed the good news, because if you're not loved, that's not good news. That's how important love is to this. If you're not loved, the gospel isn't good news. If you're not loving, no matter how right you are, you're not participating in Jesus' gospel work. Love is that important. So here, the good news. You are loved. You're loved. You're loved. You're loved. Even you, Mark. Even you are loved. You're loved. So with that established, how do we live out God's love? So, great, we're loved. Now what? Here are three very practical steps. First is we confess. We confess. We come before God and confess that we've failed and that we need God's help to love and to be able to love better. God, I have completely biffed it this week as a parent. You already know that, but let me open up my hands and tell you that and give it to you. I confess I've done that. You can fill in the blank for whatever it is you might confess. And then with our hands open, giving God that, we get to receive. So first we confess, then we receive. We receive his forgiveness in Jesus Christ. God's saying, yeah, I know you biffed it. I knew that before I called you, that you'd mess it up every day of your life, but I love you. And so receive forgiveness. That's what I did with Jesus. So just, you're forgiven. Like, oh, thank God. And while your hands are still open, you also get to receive that Holy Spirit power that empowers you to love others. Holy Spirit that lives in you and speaks through you and draws you to those positions and those places that are like, oh, this place needs love. And I can sense that because God's love is in me. And like, yeah, so let me let God's love pour out of me. So we confess, we receive, and then we practice. We practice God's love. And how do we practice? This for all of you who think everything I said is still not practical enough. For all you engineers, you 3M people, here you go. All right, practice. This is the practical. Live out 1 Corinthians 13 as a starting place. Just open it up to 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4, where it says, love is patient. And just start there. Great. This week, God, help me with my patience. Or maybe you'll take a different approach and you can read through it and just say, Holy Spirit, highlight the one for me that I'm not doing great at. I think I've been stuck at love is patient since I had my first child. And love is not easily angered is like now my mantra. So that's just where I'm at. It'll be different for you. Maybe it's love keeps no record of wrongs. And that's like, ooh, I'm really good at harboring things against people. Which our refuge students this past Wednesday night heard a fabulous message about. But whatever it is that God, whatever love God wants to move you in, and whatever practice I have faith that God is going to work that love into you and into me, because God is love, and that's his desire, that we become more and more like him, more and more like Jesus. So my prayer is that today, that he will continue to work his love into you as you receive his love. And then let his love from there pour out of you. If the church is to be on mission, if we're to have any sort of authority in this world, it's not going to come from lording it over people. It's going to come from the roots that grow up and that love that comes out of us. Really tempted to eat this right now, but then I won't be able to pray. So let's pray and I'll eat that after. Father, thank you for the sweet stuff that is your love. Thank you for your loving presence over us, and that it's not just a word we throw around, but it's the essence of our being as Jesus' people. God, forgive us for when we make your love anything less than that, when it becomes a bumper sticker or a cliche or a thing that we can throw around. God, we confess that we need your forgiveness. And in Christ, we receive your forgiveness. And would you give us your Holy Spirit to be better at it? Not because we need to earn you or earn your love, but because you want good things for us. And you have a mission for us in this world. So we receive that. We receive your forgiveness. We receive your Spirit. And would you help us to practice love this week? And would you point it out to us when we're not? And gently convict us. Say, hey, I called you to something better. You're on mission for me. Father, we give ourselves to you. Would you make us a people who love individually and a church who loves as witnesses to your love? And we pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.